This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The White Queen of Okoyong, a true story of adventure, heroism, and faith. Author: William Pringle Livingstone. Chapter 1. Tells how a little girl lived in a lowly home and played and dreamed dreams, and how a dark shadow came into her life and made her unhappy. How when she grew older she went into a factory and learned to weave, and how in her spare minutes she taught herself many things and worked amongst wild boys, and how she was sent to Africa. One cold day in December, in the city of Aberdeen, a baby girl was carried by her mother into a church to be enrolled in the kingdom of Jesus and given a name. As the minister went through the tender and beautiful ceremony, the people in the pews looked at the tiny form in her robes of white, and thought of the long years that lay before her, and wondered what she would become, because every girl and boy is like a shut casket full of mystery and promise and hope. No one knows what gifts may lie hidden within them, and what great and surprising things they may do when they grow up and go out into the world. The baby was christened Mary Slessor, and then she was wrapped up carefully again and taken home. Surely no one present ever dreamed how much good little Mary would one day do for Africa. It was not a very fine house into which Mary had been born, for her father, who was a shoemaker, did not earn much money, but her mother, a sweet and gentle woman, worked hard to keep it clean and tidy, and love makes even the poorest place sunshiny and warm. When Mary was able to run about, she played a great deal with her brother Robert, who was older than she, but she liked to help her mother too. Indeed, she seemed to be fonder of doing things for others than for herself. She did not need dolls, for more babies came into the home, and she used to nurse them and dress them and hush them to sleep. She was very good at make-believe, and one of her games was to sit in a corner and pretend that she was keeping school. If you had listened to her, you would have found that the pupils she was busy teaching and keeping in order were children with skins as black as coal. The reason was this: her mother took a great interest in all she heard on Sundays about the dark lands beyond the seas, where millions of people had never heard of Jesus. The church to which she belonged, the United Presbyterian Church, had sent out many brave men and women to various parts of the world to fight the evils of heathenism, and a new mission had just begun amongst a savage race in a wild country called Calabar in West Africa, and everyone in Scotland was talking about it, and the perils and hardships of the missionaries. Mrs. Slessor used to come home with all the news about the work, and the children would gather about her knees and listen to stories of the strange, cruel customs of the natives, and how they killed the twin babies, until their eyes grew big and round and their hearts raced with fear and they snuggled close to her side. Mary was very sorry for these helpless bush children, and often thought about them, and that was why she made them her play scholars. She dreamed, too, of going out someday to that terrible land and saving the lives of the twinnies, and sometimes she would look up and say, "Mother, I want to be a missionary and go out and teach the black boys and girls real ways." Then Robert would retort in the tone that boys often use to their sisters, "But you're only a girl, and girls can't be missionaries. I'm going to be one, and you can come out with me, and if you're good I may let you up into my pulpit beside me." Mrs. Slessor was amused at their talk, and well pleased too, for she had a longing that her boy should work abroad in the service of Jesus when he became a man. But that was not to be, for soon afterwards Robert fell ill and died, so Mary became the eldest. A dark shadow, darker than death, gathered over the home. Mr. Slessor learned the habit of taking strong drink, and became a slave to it, and he began to spend a large part of his money in the public house, and his wife and children had not the comfort they ought to have had. Matters became so bad that something had to be done. It was thought that if Mr. Slessor could be got away from the bad companions who led him astray, he might do better. So the home was broken up, and the family journeyed to Dundee, the busy smoky town on the River Tay, where there were many large mills and factories, and here for a time they lived in a little house with a bit of garden in front. That garden was at first a delight to Mary, but afterwards she lost her pleasure in it, for her father used to dig in it on Sunday and make people think he did not love God's day. She was now old enough to look after the younger children, and very well she did it. Often she took them long walks, climbing the steep streets to see the green fields or going down to feel the fresh smell of the sea. Sometimes her mother gave her a sixpence, and they went and had a ride on the merry-go-round. It was the custom then for girls and boys to go barefooted in the summer, and Mary liked it so much that she never afterwards cared to wear shoes and stockings. On Sundays they all trotted away to church, clean and sweet, each with a peppermint to suck during the sermon, and afterwards they went to Sunday school. As a rule, Mary was good and obedient, though, like most girls, she sometimes got into trouble. Her hair was reddish then, and her brothers would tease her and call her carrots, and she did not like that. She loved a prank too, and was sometimes naughty. Once or twice, she played truant from the Sunday school. She was always very vexed afterwards, for she could not bear to see her mother's face when she heard of her wrongdoing, it was so white and sad. The quiet little mother did not punish her. She would draw her instead into a room and kneel down and pray for her. "Oh, mother," Mary would say, "I would rather you whip me." But all that soon passed away, for she had been dreaming another dream, a very sweet one, which always set her heart a longing and a thrilling, and it now came true and changed her life. It was the biggest thing, and the happiest that ever happened to her. She gave her heart to Jesus. Very shyly one night she crept up to her mother, nestled close to her, and laid her head on her knee, and then whispered the wonderful news. "I'll try, mother," she said, "to be a good girl and a comfort to you." Her mother was filled with joy, and both went about for long afterwards singing in their hearts, "If only the shadow would lift the little house, mother." But it settled down more darkly than ever. We can change the place where we stay and wander far, but it is not so easy to change our habits. Mr. Slessor was now bringing in so little money that his wife was forced to go and work in one of the mills in order to buy food and clothes for the children. Mary became the little house mother, and how busy her hands and feet were, how early she was up and how late she tumbled into bed, and how bravely she met all her troubles. Tears might steal into her eyes when she felt faint and hungry, but it was always a bright and smiling face that welcomed the tired mother home at night. Gloomier grew the shadow. More money was needed to keep the home, and Mary, a slim girl of 11, was the next to go out and become a breadwinner. One morning she went into a big factory and stood in the midst of machines and wheels and whirling belts, and at first was bewildered and a little afraid. But she was only allowed to stay for half a day. The other half, she had to go to a school in the works where the girls were taught to read and write and count. She was fond of the reading, but did not like doing the sums. The figures on the board danced before her eyes, and she could not follow the working out of the problems, and sometimes the teacher punished her by making her stand until the lesson was finished. But she was clever with her fingers, and soon knew all about weaving. How proud she was when she ran home with her first week's earnings. She laid them in the lap of her mother, who cried over them and wrapped them up and put them away. She could not just then find it in her heart to spend such precious money. By the time she was 14, Mary was working a large machine and being paid a good wage. But she had to toil very hard for it. She rose at 5 o'clock in the morning, when the factory whistle blew, and was in the works by 6, and except for 2 hours off for meals, she was busy at her task until 6 in the evening. In the warm summer days, she did not go home, but carried her dinner with her and ate it sitting beside the loom, and sometimes she went away by herself and walked in the park. Saturday afternoons and Sundays were her own, but they were usually spent in helping her mother. Her dress was coarse and plain, and she wore no pretty ornaments, though she liked them as much as her companions did, for she was learning to put aside all the things she did not really need, and by she came not to miss them, and found pleasure instead in making others happy. She would have been quite content if only her father had been different. But there was no hope now of a better time. The shadow became so black that it was like night when there are no stars in the sky. Mrs. Slessor and Mary had a big burden to bear and a grim battle to fight. In their distress they clung to one another and prayed to Jesus for help and strength, for they of themselves could do little. On Saturday nights, Mr. Slessor came home late and treated them unkindly, so that Mary was often forced to go out into the cold streets and wait until he had gone to sleep. As she wandered about, she felt very lonely and very miserable, and sometimes sobbed as if her heart would break. When she passed the bright windows of the places where drink was sold, she wondered why people were allowed to ruin men and women in such a way, and she clenched her hands and resolved that when she grew up she would war against this terrible thing which destroyed the peace and happiness of homes. But at last, the trouble came to an end. One tragic day Mary stood and looked down with a great awe upon the face of her father lying white and still in death. What she went through in these days made her often sad and downcast, for she had a loving heart and suffered sorely when anyone was rough to her or ill-treated her. But good came out of it too. She was like a white starry flower which grows on the walls and verandas of houses in the tropics. The hot sunshine is not able to draw perfume from it, but as soon as darkness falls, its fragrance scents the air and comes stealing through the open windows and doors. So it was with Mary. She grew sweeter in the darkness of trouble. It was in the shadows of life that she learned to be patient and brave and unselfish. We must not think less, but more of her for coming out of such a home. It is not always the girls and boys who are highly favored that grow up to do the best and biggest things in life. Some of the men and women to whom the world owes most had a hard time when they were young. The home life of President Lincoln, who freed millions of slaves in America, was like Mary's, yet his name has become one of the most famous in history. No girl or boy should despair because they are poor or lonely or crushed down in any way. Let them fight on, quietly and patiently, and in the end better things and happier times will come. Mrs. Slessor now left the factory, and for a time kept a little shop, in which Mary used to help, especially on Saturday afternoons and nights when trade was busiest. The girl was still dreaming dreams about the wonderful days that lay before her, but unlike many others who do the same, she did her best to make hers come true. She wanted to learn things, and she found that books would tell her, and so she was led into the great world of knowledge. The more she read, the more she wanted to know. So eager was she that when she left home for her work, she slipped a book into her pocket and glanced at it in the streets. She did not know then about Dr. Livingstone, the African missionary and traveler, but she did exactly what he had done when he was a boy. She propped a book on a corner of the loom in the factory and read whenever she had a moment to spare. Her companions tell how they used to see her take out a little notebook, put it on the weaver's beam, and jot down her thoughts. She was always writing, they say. Sometimes it was poetry, sometimes an essay, sometimes a letter to a friend. But she never neglected her work. How different her lot was from that of most girls of today. They have leisure for their lessons, and they learn music and do fancy work and keep house and bake, and how many hate it all. Mary had only a few precious minutes, but she made the most of them. The books she read were not stories, but ones like Milton's Paradise Lost and Carlyle's Sartor Resartus, and so deep did she become in them at night that sometimes she forgot everything and read on and on through the quiet hours, and only came to herself with a start when she heard the warning whistle of the factory in the early morning. She was fond of all good books, but the one she liked most and knew better than any was the Bible. She pored over it so often that she remembered much of it by heart. In the Bible class she was so quick and so ready to answer questions that Mr. Baxter, her minister, used to say, "Now, Mary Slessor, don't answer any more questions till I bid you." When everyone else failed, he would turn to her with, "Now, Mary," and she always had her reply ready. She was never tired of the story of Jesus, especially as it is told in the Gospel of St. John, for there he appeared to her so kind and winsome and lovable. When she thought of all he did, how he came from his own beautiful heaven to save the world from what is sinful and sad, and how he was made to suffer and at last was put to death, and how his teaching has brought peace and safety and sunshine into the lives of millions of women and girls, she felt she must do something for him to show her love and thankfulness and devotion. He says we must do as he did, and try to make people better and happier, and so I too must do my best and join in the war against all that is evil and unlovely and unrestful in the world. So she thought to herself. She did not say, "I am only a girl, what can I do?" She knew that when a general wanted an army to fight a strong enemy, he did not call for officers only, but for soldiers, hosts of them, and especially for those who were young. "I can be a soldier," Mary said humbly. "Dear Lord, I will do what I can. Here are my heart and head and hands and feet. Use me for anything that I can do." The first thing that she did was to take a class of little girls in the Sunday school, and thus she began to teach others before she was educated herself, but it is not always those who are best trained who can teach best. The heart of Mary was so full of deep true love for Jesus that it caused her face to shine and her eyes to smile and her lips to speak kind words, and that is the sort of learning that wins others to Him. Wishart Church, to which she went, was built over shops and looked down upon the old port gate and upon streets and lanes which were filled at night with big boys and girls who seemed to have no other place to go to and nothing to do but lounge and swear and fight. Mary felt she would like to do something for them. By and by, when a mission was begun in a little house in Queen Street, there is a brass inscription upon the wall now telling about Mary. She went to the superintendent and said, "Will you take me as a teacher?" "Gladly," he said, but she looked so small and frail that he was afraid the work would be too rough for her. What a time she had at first. The boys and girls did not want anybody to bother about them. Those who came to the meeting were wild and noisy. Those who remained outside threw stones and mud and tried to stop the work. Mary faced them, smiling and unafraid, and dared them to touch her. Some grew ashamed of worrying the brave little teacher, and these she won over to her side. But there were others with sullen eyes and clenched fists who would not give in, and they did their best to make her life a misery. One night a band of the most violent lay in wait for her, and she found herself suddenly in their midst. They hustled and threatened her. "We'll do for you if you don't leave us alone," they cried. She was quaking with fear, but she did not show it. She just breathed a prayer for help and looked at them with her quiet eyes. "I will not give up," she replied. "You can do what you like." "All right," shouted the leader, a big hulking lad. "Here goes." Out of his pocket, he took a lump of lead to which was tied a bit of cord and began to swing it round her head. The rest of the gang looked on breathless, wondering at the courage of the girl. The lead came nearer and swished past her brow. Pale, calm, unflinching, she stood waiting for the blow that would fell her to the ground. Suddenly the lad jerked away the weapon and let it fall with a crash. "We can't force her, boys," he cried, "she's game." And like beaten foes, they followed her and went to the meeting and into her class, and after that there was no more trouble. The boys fell under her spell, grew fond of her, and in their shy way did all they could to help her. On Saturday afternoons, she would take them into the country away from the temptations of the streets, and sought to make them gentle and kind and generous. Some of the most wayward amongst them gave their hearts to Jesus, and afterwards grew to be good and useful men. What was it that gave her such an influence over these rude and unruly boys? They did not know. She was not what is called a pretty girl. She was plain and quiet and simple, and she was poorly clad. But she was somehow different from most teachers. Perhaps it was because she loved them so much, for the love that is real and pure and unselfish is the greatest power in the world. One of the pens or closes where Mary visited the boys in her class. Through the hearts of the boys, Mary found her way to their homes in the slums, and paid visits to their mothers and sisters, and saw that life to them was often very hard and wretched. The other mission workers used to go two and two, but she often went alone. Once she was a long time away, and when she came back she said laughingly, "I've been dining with the McDonald's in Quarry Pend." "Indeed," said someone, "and did you get a clean plate and spoon?" "Oh, never mind that," replied Mary. "I've got into their house and been asked to come back, and that's all I care about." She always went in the same spirit in which Jesus would have gone. Sometimes she would sit by the fire with the baby on her knees. Sometimes she would take tea with the family, drinking out of a broken cup. Sometimes she would help the mother to finish a bit of work. And always she cheered up tired and anxious hearts, and left sunshine and peace where there had been only the blackness of despair. No one could be long in her company without feeling better, and not a few of her friends came, through her, to know and love and work for Jesus. 3 weeks after I knew her, says one of her old factory mates, I became a different girl. How eager and earnest she was. Oh, she said to a companion, I wonder what we would do or dare for Jesus. Would we be burned at the stake? Would we give our lives for his sake? She did work hard, says another, and whatever she did with heart and soul. When the mission was removed to the rooms under the church, the superintendent said, We shall need a charwoman to give the place a thorough cleaning. Nonsense, said Mary, we will clean it ourselves. You ladies clean such a dirty hall. Ladies, cried Mary, we are no ladies, we are just ordinary working folk. Next night Mary and another teacher were found, with sleeves turned up and aprons on, busy with pails of water and brushes scrubbing out the rooms. Like other young people, she had her troubles, big and little, and these she met bravely. Evil-minded persons, jealous of her goodness, sometimes said unkind things about her, but she never paid any heed to them. She always did what she thought was right, and went her own way. On Saturdays she used to put her hair in curl papers, and her companions teased her a lot about it and tried to laugh her out of the habit, but she just laughed back. When she and two or three friends met during the meal hour and held a little prayer meeting opposite the factory, the other girls would come and peep in, and one of her companions would be vexed and scold them. Dinna bother Janet, she would say quietly, we needna mind what they do. The house in Queen Street, Dundee, where Mary Slessor first taught as a mission teacher. She was not always serious, but could enjoy fun and frolic with the wildest. Once while walking in the country with a girl, she knocked playfully at some cottage doors and ran away. Oh, Mary, said her friend, I'm shocked at you. Mary only laughed and said, a little nonsense now and then is relished by the wisest men. From one old friend, we get a picture of her at this time. Her face was always shining and happy. With her fresh skin, her short ringlets, and her firm mouth, she somehow always made me think of a farmer's daughter coming to market with butter and eggs. Her life during these years was a training for what she had to do in the future. She must have had an inkling of it, for her dreams now were all of service in the far lands beyond the seas. Through the gloom of the smoky streets, she was always seeing visions of tropical rivers and tangled jungle and heathen huts amongst palm trees. And above the noise of the factory, she was hearing the cries of the little bush children. And she longed to leave busy Dundee with its churches and Sunday schools and go out and help where help was most needed. She did not say anything, for she knew it was her brother John that her mother was anxious to make a missionary. He was a big lad, but very delicate, and there came a time when the doctor said he must leave the cold climate of Scotland or die. He sailed to New Zealand, but it was too late and he passed away there. His mother grieved again over her lost hopes, and Mary, who was very fond of him, wept bitterly. As she went about her work, she repeated the hymn, Lead Kindly Light, to herself, finding comfort in the last two lines. And with the morn those angel faces smile, which I have loved long since and lost a while. And then she came back to her dazzling daydream. Could she not, after all, be the missionary? But she was not educated, and she was the chief breadwinner of the family, and her mother leant upon her so much. How could she manage it? She thought it all out and at last said, I can do it. I will do it. She was one of the cleverest weavers in the factory, and she began to do extra work, thus earning a bigger wage and saving more money. She studied very hard. She practiced speaking at meetings until she learned how to put her thoughts into clear and simple words. But it was a weary, weary time, for she spent 14 years within the walls of the factory. Thousands of other girls, of course, were doing the same, and sometimes they got very tired but had just to go bravely on. In one of her poems, Mrs. Browning tells us what it was like, how the revolving wheels seemed to make everything turn too, the heads and hearts of the girls, the walls, the sky seen out of the high windows, even the black flies on the ceiling. All day the iron wheels are droning, and sometimes we could pray, O ye wheels, breaking out in a mad moaning, stop, be silent for today. But they never did stop, and the girls had only their hopes and dreams to make them patient and brave. One day there flashed through the land a telegram, which caused much excitement and sorrow. Africa was then an unknown country, vast and mysterious, and haunted by all the horrors of slavery and heathenism. For a long time there had been tramping through it a white man, a Scotsman, David Livingstone, hero of heroes, who had been gradually finding out the secrets of its lakes and rivers and peoples. Sometimes he was lost for years. The telegram which came told of his lonely death in a hut in the heart of the continent. Everyone asked, "What is to be done now? Who is to take up the work of the great pioneer and help to save the natives from misery and death?" Amongst those whose hearts leapt at the call was Mary Slessor. She went to her mother. "Mother," she said, "I am going to offer myself as a missionary. But do not fret. I will be able to give you part of my salary, and that, with the earnings of Susan and Janie, will keep the home in comfort." "My lassie," was the reply, "I'll willingly let you go. You'll make a fine missionary, and I'm sure God will be with you." Some of her friends wondered at her. They knew she was not specially brave. Indeed, was not her timidity a joke amongst them? "Why," they said, "she is even afraid of dogs. When she sees one coming down the street, she goes into a passage until it is passed."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.